issues related to quantification of nutrition and food intake. But my lab in general works in development of sensor as an application, what is now known as artificial intelligence, to problems of measuring health-related human behaviors. Just to give you some ideas, one of the projects that we have and it's still ongoing is a physical activity monitor. It's an insole. It's very accurately differentiates exactly what you're doing. Sitting, standing, walking, going upstairs, going downstairs, associates with energy expenditure, measures gait, whatever. Another health-related behavior that we work with is cigarette smoking. So we have systems that study cigarette smoking, detect cigarette smoking without asking the person whether they smoked or not. We're also actually working on producing some interesting new metrics of smoking, biomarkers of smoking behavior. Another related project is diet and ingestive behavior. That's what I'm going to talk about. We do work with infants. We do work with adults. We may do some work with kids, and these are different devices that we put together. Before I begin, however, let's talk about measurement of energy. This is your house. In your house, you have multiple devices. You have a washing machine, you have a TV, you have light, you have a heater. They all consume different kinds of energy. It could be reactive energy, it could be active. So how do we measure this energy? Anyone knows? That guy sits outside of your house, but let's look at what goes into this guy. And this is just a tiny, tiny part of the spec which is related to this energy measurement device. A key highlight, typical accuracy within plus minus 0.2%. You don't want your electric bill to be plus minus 50%, do you? Okay, so here you go. It's an accurate measurement. Look at this one, standards. This device complies with a lot of standards which tell what it should measure under which conditions. Okay? What do we have here? Do we have a definition of accuracy? Do we have a definition of precision? Or standards as it relates to measurement? So that's what we're trying to work with, and I'm going to talk about eating behaviors and different questions which relate to eating behaviors. Question number one, when we detect that you're actually eating without asking you. Second, if you're eating, so what is that you're eating? Third question, which is totally separate, how much you're eating? And actually, how much has so multiple definitions? Is it energy, you know, macronutrients, micronutrients, what is that what we eat? And where and how we eat it? You know, what is the behavior? You know, people eat differently. So how do we measure that? And what is the environment for eating? And finally, can we change eating behavior maybe based on some of these measures? Well, there is no acceptable method to do even combinations of these things. So, and again, this is just self-advertisement. So we have this device. It's called automatic ingestion monitor. It's a wearable device. It's worn on eyeglasses. The reason it's worn on eyeglasses is twofold. First of all, whenever you eat, you're looking at your food. You cannot eat without looking. I mean, even if you're grabbing something to the side, you bring it to the mouth, it's in front of your eyes. Hands are supposed to be in front of your eyes. So, compared to other wearable cameras, and there are some, this has a distinct advantage, which is that we always capture the food because we're always looking at the food. Second, it has a sensor which actually detects when you're eating. And that's important not only to how we trigger the images, but to privacy questions. I'll show you a little bit about that. So that's the device. And so I've been doing this for a lot of time, so some of this research is old, some of this research is new, some of this research is not yet published. But when we eat, we can actually, first device we published was this guy, and I don't, okay, maybe this, nope, all right. Red button, okay, red button, okay. This device worn on the lanyard, we were actually being able to detect about 90% accuracy. Detect food intake over 24 hours, and I'm not kidding, it's 24 hours that they slept with this. So as far as I know, that's the only device which was actually used round of clock We did not have any night eaters, so I cannot talk about that. I wish we had, but very interesting. All right, let me see. So another newer device we have demonstrated we can avoid using. So that the previous one I showed had a sticky sensor, like a Band-Aid. You had to stick it to your skin. People with long hair would realize that's not a good idea. So we published a study, a tiny, tiny accelerometer, same accelerometer which is used in physical activity monitors, if mounted on the frame of eyeglasses, can very accurately detect when you're eating. And that's actually the modality that we're using right now. What we eat is, again, the camera. So we have a wearable camera. I already told you about the advantage that we're always looking at the food. Here is just some images from a meal being captured. And those are high resolution still images. If there is some writing in the image, you can read it and so on and so forth. But the question is, you know, what do you do with those images now you've got them? And so what we have here, we have developed a software for, at this moment of time, manual annotation. But what is important about this software, if you look at this axis, these are food intake events picked up by the sensor. So we don't have to go through the whole day of images. And as a matter of fact, we can use sensor to trigger the camera only when the person is eating. And that alleviates a lot of privacy concerns. We actually have a questionnaire that we ask participants in our study. It's not published yet, but I can tell you it does solve privacy concerns. It goes like from, you know, 8-9 to 1-2. So, and I don't know, do you have, can you play, it's a video? Can you play, there is, yeah, just play button. So as you can see, it's like a full day, but when I click on this, it takes me to the actual food intake episode, and then we can annotate this food intake episode. I mean, he's marking true events and other. But we can annotate, and we have a variety of databases, including USDA. We have FNDDS. We have IRND. We have West African food database. We have Kenyan food database. And now, talking about standards, all of these databases use different format. Okay. So, and what he's doing, he's adding a food intake data. And actually, just to illustrate some points, so this comes from either USDA or FNDDS, but if you look, this is an eating episode, breakfast. It's 2 p.m. This is not a joke. This is breakfast for a graduate student. All right, self-defined, he slept until 1, he got up, he had breakfast at 2. So, again, talking about eating behaviors, breakfast at 2, so it's kind of unconventional thinking about breakfast. Okay, so how much we eat? We could use sensors to actually estimate mass. And the estimation of mass, there are papers published about how many hand-to-mouth gestures you make, how many bites you make, how many chews you make, how many swallows we make. We use chews. So the temporalis muscle here on your temple, it's really good to measure how many chews you take during food intake. And we have published a paper recently that was a sticky sensor. Now we have a different sensor, which is not sticky, but was about 4% error, and this is mean absolute, so it's not signed error, it's unsigned. So we can very accurately count chews, and as I showed in my previous slide, we could actually use number of chews to quantify mass and energy of ingestion, roughly, not very accurately. But what we could also do, we could use this information to look at how we eat the food. Okay, so if there are four settings of identical food, you have four people, are they going to eat the same? They are not going to eat the same. This is called meal microstructure. It's one of the less explored dimensions of eating, as a matter of fact. And it includes episode duration, how, out of the eating episode, how long you actually eat. Number of eating bouts, rate of ingestion, chewing frequency, you know, all those measures. And before we begin to talk about measuring this sort of meal microstructure, we need to talk about time resolution with which we want to quantify food intake. So the very first step is, again, as I mentioned, is to detect whether you're eating or not. So if we're looking at eating bouts, we have to detect eating bouts. Let's say we have a sensor which detects eating bouts. What should be the time resolution? Is it 1 second, 2 seconds, 1 minute? So, and literature has anything from 32 milliseconds to 8 minutes. And we've done a study also recently published about, so what do we need to characterize meal microstructure? And statistically, it comes anything below 5 seconds. So if you have a sensor and the sensor can detect food intake with at least 5 second resolution or lower, then it should be good to describe the microstructure of eating. You could differentiate those things. What does it tell us? Well, it tells us about eating our food, and one very important distinction is lab versus field studies. So using this method that I just described, what we've done, we took one study which was completely lab, and of course it was with sensors, so we invited people and they sat in the lab. And another one was almost unrestricted. We had an observation dorm room with multiple rooms where people came and left as they wanted, and we were observing them eating. And we looked at multiple meal microstructure parameters, how they differ between these two studies. And they are significantly different across everything. This is just one measure. Number of ingested bouts, unrestricted meal in both cases. They ate whatever they want from cafeteria. Look at this. Red one is filled, and actually I think this is the incorrect. We observed a lot more ingestion bouts in the field because people are not that constrained. In the lab, they just want to eat and get out. Whereas in the field, they talk to each other, they take breaks. We had 2 hour breaks, so half a sandwich, 2 hour break, half a sandwich. How do we count? Is it the same lunch? Or is it two lunches? I don't know. So a lot of things about how to characterize these things. How we can change what we eat. We actually looked at using our sensor systems to actually modify the amount of food eaten by people. And the way it works is we had an individual, it was a doubly blind study. Individuals did not know, we had to deceive them, that we are trying to mess with their food intake. They were told they're testing a sensor system. And then they came and they had a baseline visit. Baseline visit was like this bowl of rice, as much as nobody finished it, as much as they want to eat. They gave us satiety metrics at the end. Then after some washout period, they came back, and then same sensor system through a laptop, they were given audio feedback, how they are progressing to their target. But that's when we manipulated the target. In one visit, randomly assigned, it was 75% of the baseline. On another visit, was same as the baseline. And we want to see if they're going to eat the same, just as following the guidance from the computer. What we observed is that here is baseline visit, and on average they ate about 500 grams, it was fried rice. And on 100 target visit, when they were given feedback, but it was the same, driven by number of chews as the original, it's 1-to-1 match. But when we manipulated the target, they ate less. Not as much less as we wanted them to eat. So that's an interesting observation. I don't know the explanation, we need to study it. However, hunger ratings, straight flat. So, but this is just one meal. We don't know about compensation during the day. Maybe they ate later, you know, so who knows. But at least some idea that potentially we could use these sensor systems trying to intervene with people eating behavior. And so where do you want to go from here? This is not my work, this is work by Carol Boucher at Delp. They have this smartphone-based system where they take picture of the food. It has to be at a certain angle. The participant has to take it, and so on and so forth. But very nice, they have a whole framework for arriving at the nutritional content. So right now, for example, we're working with them to take our newer AIM device. This is a concept, so it's going to be much slimmer for wear. This is actual data that we captured in one of the studies with using deep learning, artificial intelligence, whatever you want to call it, to detect foods in the image and then to recognize. So this is jam, this is water, this is bread. And so we can recognize, we can potentially estimate portion size, arrive at some nutritional information. So now what? Well, we have an image of a glass of milk. Did it come from this bottle, this bottle, this bottle, that bottle, or maybe out one of this? So while we really want to have sensors, again, sensors just, even for privacy, because if you want to study food intake, you better have your camera running on during food intake. But just imaging by itself is probably not going to get to this 0.2% accuracy that we want from our residential power meter. So what do we do? Well, there are other sensors. One thing is potential for multispectral imaging. This is soda under different wavelength of illumination. You can see actually it looks clear in infrared. And you could explore differences in absorption at different frequencies, trying to arrive at some nutritional content. We already saw this one. What this one doesn't show, however, is the transceiver, which is rather large. It's, it's something that has to be worn outside. So what are my conclusions? You know, when we're studying food intake and eating behavior, we need to split it into well-defined questions because the answer may be different for all of those questions. If we're using technology, there is no single technology which can cover it all. We do need to have a combination of multiple sensors, image data, and who knows what else to arrive at very high precision. And questions of accuracy, precision, and standardization need to be addressed because we need to know what may we measure and under what conditions and what are the characteristics of the measurement being taken. So that's it. Thank you very much. I want to acknowledge a lot of people, nutritionists, endocrinologists, psychologists, psychiatrists, exercise scientists, and everyone else who collaborated with me, and of course, NIH support. That's it. Thank you very much. Good question. For many of these studies, it's mostly university personnel. I agree with that. It's not necessarily graduate students alone because all of the studies have a huge response from staff, okay? So it's a mixture of graduate students and staff. But again, for big studies, we actually have a proper recruitment, community recruitment. So for example, we're running a study in Boston right now, and it's advertised to the Boston area and so on and so forth. So it's
willing to wear the device, glasses, because maybe they don't wear glasses.
Correct.
Maybe they wear contacts. Was this for 24 hours? Was it for several days?
All right, so we have multiple studies. When people don't wear glasses, we provide glasses with non-corrective lens. People normally wear this pretty well, so and we can detect compliance and wear time. So our typical wear time is over 12 hours, out of which they're compliant over 90% of the time, so we get about 11 hours of data. They advise to take glasses off for privacy reasons for any private events in between. That was on a two-day study. We have several data collections. For the one-week study, we are running a 10-day study at this moment of time, so we'll see how well, you know, what are the final compliance data are going to be.
Yeah, it'd be very interesting if you think about NHANES study or any other survey getting participants when you're, you know, consumption surveys.
One interesting observation I want to add to this. We are for sure getting eating episodes not reported. They have to do self-report on certain days. We're getting those eating episodes, and it's mostly something like a Snickers bar or some high-calorie dense food that they get on the go. Again, it's not published yet, but it will be, I hope.
Good. And then the cost of the device, final sort of?
Oh, it's inexpensive. It's expensive in small quantities, but in, you know, whatever your consumer devices go for nowadays, you know, less than $100.
The cost of the analysis?
Cost of the analysis is a different thing. So
right.
If you're doing human analysis, it's pretty high. But when we computerize it completely, it's going to be.
That's the goal.
Yeah, that's the goal, yeah.
Okay, George Sand is going to get the last question.
So your chew sensor, what do you do with food that you don't need chewing, like soup and beverage?
Perfect question. Actually, even soup we do chew. Even beverage, many beverages we don't chew, we actually suck. Yeah. So this is the same motion, it's picked up and recognized the same way, with the only exception of hot beverages and anything that you sip, okay? And that's where we are working on actually the, you know, convergence of two technologies, where we want to recognize what's in the image. And if we see wine, which you don't gulp, but you sip, and therefore, you know, the chewing sensor will not pick up. Just to merge two data streams, data fusion, and provide it a more reliable estimate.
Thank you very much. What we're going to do is have one more talk, and since part of my job description is to use my Senate records, Naomi will be bumped, so right after lunch.